Hello and welcome to today's book reading session of Preparing for the Day After, a picture ebook. Preparing for the Day After is a photojournalistic treatise on disaster mitigation published by me, Malini Shankar, and Walter Keller for the 10th anniversary of the Asian tsunami. Tonight we will learn about the various strands of traditional wisdom and their efficacy in disaster mitigation. Today I will be reading out part 1 of chapter 11, but let us first recap what we have learned in the previous book reading sessions before starting tonight's session. Water and sanitation is central to developmental discourse. Culture-sensitive food security also has evolved out of local agrometeorological conditions prevalent in an area. Livelihoods based on local agrometeorological conditions are the best means of ensuring livelihood security. Climate change adaptation, menstrual hygiene especially for indigenous women, solid waste management, universal health care access, sustainable development goals, they are all part of development agenda. Media personnel have to be trained in reporting disaster preparedness or the lack of it at district level. Disaster is the impact of a calamity on the human landscape. This includes the impact on lives, livelihoods, livestock and landscape. Now let's begin with the chapter on traditional wisdom. About 10 days after the Asian tsunami, news reports started emerging that many of the indigenous people of Andaman Nicobar Islands like the Jarabas, the Great Andamanese, Onges and Sentinelese living in Andaman Nicobar Islands in India, the Smaug in Simulu in Indonesia, and the Mokan in Thailand had largely escaped unscathed from the terror of the tsunami waves thanks to their traditional wisdom, which only they could interpret as an early warning. Armed with their traditional wisdom, the indigenous folk fled to higher grounds and escaped unhurt, the news reports said. Leading international news agencies like the BBC and the Interpress Service published reports on indigenous people in India's Andaman Nicobar Islands being unscathed. I will now read out two such reports from the BBC and the IPS. Stone Age tribes living on India's remote Andaman Nicobar Islands not only survived the devastating December 26th tsunami, triggered by an undersea earthquake whose epicenter was closest to their homelands, but may have actually had a few lessons in reading natural early warning systems for their less perceptive Asian neighbors, say scientists. While close to 150,000 people have been confirmed dead on the coast of a dozen countries around the Bay of Bengal, after being caught unaware by giant killer waves, the Onges, the Jarabas, the Sentinelese, and the Great Andamanese who live in the archipelago escaped unscathed because they took to the forests and higher ground well in time. These tribes live close to nature and are known to heed biological warning signs like changes in the cries of birds and the behavior patterns of land and marine animals, said Dr. V. Raghavendra Rao, director of the Kolkata-based Anthropological Survey of India, when speaking to IPS in a telephonic interview. Based on reports from his field staff on the badly devastated archipelago of 550 islands strung out between Burma's main port of Rangoon and Indonesia's Sumatra Island, Rao confirmed to IPS that there are no known casualties among the five tribes, although there are unconfirmed reports of a few missing Onges. The Andaman and Nicobar Islands have a population of around 500,000 people, of which the tribals form less than 30,000 people. And the biggest group of them is Nicobarese at around 20,000 people. Rao and other ASI experts, that the Anthropological Survey of India experts, believe that the tribes may hold the key to building a resource base for a reliable and cost-effective coastal warning system against future catastrophes. Experts around the world have blamed the unusually high human toll from the tsunami, which was spawned by a huge undersea earthquake in the northern tip of Sumatra Island, on the absence of a reliable early warning system such as the sophisticated Pacific Tsunami Warning Center based in Honolulu, Hawaii. But top Indian scientists think that such a system may not be practical for the countries of the Indian Ocean Rim where tsunamis are extremely rare. Building up a tsunami prediction system network for the Indian Ocean will be a gigantic effort. After all, we cannot build shelters against 25-foot or 7.62-meter high waves to cover hundreds of kilometers of coastline, said Dr. S. Z. Kasem, India's best-known oceanographer and vice-chairman of the Society for Indian Ocean Studies. As soon as things settle down, we are planning to document the vast and valuable indigenous intangible knowledge and survival skills that exist on the islands, not only on impending catastrophes, but also on herbs and medicinal plants. Rao, one of the few Indian officials authorized to speak on the subject, said, immediate documentation is important because we also need to record how the tribes that live by hunting and foraging adapt to the major geomorphological changes brought to their habitat on the islands by the 26th December events, he added. These tribes have origins reaching into Mesolithic and Upper Paleolithic era, that is between 20,000 to 60,000 years old, and efforts at scientifically studying their unique genetic characteristic have been made in collaboration with the Hyderabad-based Center for Cellular and Molecular Biology, that's called CCMB. DNA studies carried out by the CCMB, that is the Center for Cellular and Molecular Biology, have shown the Onges who inhabit reservations on Newgong Creek and the South Bay of Little Andaman Island to be the most primitive of the tribes and closely related to African pygmies. That also makes them the most endangered, with fewer than 100 individuals now known to exist, partly as a result of catching diseases like hepatitis from contact with outsiders that began under British colonial rule around 1886. Another Negrito group, the Jarawas on Great Andaman Island, suffer not only as a result of diseases introduced by outsiders, but also because of punitive expeditions carried out by the British and the Japanese, who occupied the islands and built bunkers and fortifications on them during the Second World War. Since the construction of the Andaman Trunk Road, connecting the administrative center of Port Blair with Digiport in Northern Andaman, the Jarawas have been increasingly coming into contact with Indian settlers who originally came to build the road but then stayed on as encroachers. The Sentinelese, who are believed to be originally an offshoot of the Onges, live on North Sentinel Island, west of South Andaman, and are probably the last of the world's Paleolithic people that have no contact with the rest of the world because the island is completely out of bounds to outsiders. That's the North Sentinel Island, where the Sentinelese live. Scientists believe that because of the extreme isolation of the Sentinelese, the tribe has become biomedically valuable. They warn that these tribes' people in the future could be targeted by bioprospectors for valuable genetic traits that may have long ago vanished in other ethnic or racial groups. Confirmation of their safety came from the Indian Coast Guard, which carried out surveys over the 60 square kilometer Sentinel Island last week on the low-flying helicopters, which were greeted with arrows and spears by the hostile Sentinelese. The Director General of the Coast Guard, Vice Admiral A.K. Singh, said on Monday that he was relieved to see the hostility because it was a sure sign that the Sentinelese were fighting fit and not interested in receiving outside help following the tsunami. He had pictures of Sentinelese aiming arrows at his low-flying chopper to prove the point. Apart from the four Negrito groups, the southern part of the archipelago, that is the Nicobar group, is home to tribes of Mongoloid origin and Malay origin, like the reclusive Shompens, numbering around 300, and the more sophisticated Nicobarese, who may have migrated from Indonesia's Sumatra Island nearby. Most of the tribal victims of the tsunami were Nicobarese, and as many as a quarter of their population of 20,000 people, who are mostly coastal farmers and followers of the Christian faith, may have perished when the killer waves struck. Following the December 26th tsunami, Indian authorities have refused permission for international volunteer agencies seeking to go beyond Port Blair administrative headquarters to carry out relief work on the grounds that they do not want the aborigines to be disturbed in any way. Besides the need to protect the aborigines, the Andaman and Nicobar Islands bristles with defense installations and has, since 2001, supported a joint service command involving elements of the Army, Navy and Air Force and Coast Guard under a single command. Here is another news item from the BBC website. The link of both these articles have been put up in the description box and also will be put up as captions here. Traditional knowledge and handed down from generation to generation helped to save ancient tribes on India's Andaman Nicobar Islands from the worst of the tsunami, anthropologists say. But other isolated communities who moved to the islands from Southeast Asia centuries ago fared far worse than the indigenous peoples. Evidence suggests the aboriginal tribes, some of the oldest and the most isolated in the world, have oral traditions apparently developed from previous earthquakes that may have allowed them to escape to higher ground before the massive tsunami struck the island chain of Indonesia. The Ongye tribe, for example, have lived on Little Andaman for between 30 to 50,000 years, and though they are on the verge of extinction, almost all of the 100 or so people left seem to have survived the 26th December quake and the devastating waves which followed. Their folklore talks of huge shaking of ground followed by a high wall of water, according to Manish Chandi, an environmental protection worker who has studied the tribes and spoke to some Ongyes after the disaster. When the earthquake struck, the Ongyes moved to higher ground deep inside their forest and escaped the fury of the waves that entered the settlements. He told the BBC News website after talking to some of the inhabitants who knew some Hindi as well as their own ancient languages. He said another aboriginal people, the Jarawa, on South and Middle Andaman also fled to higher ground before the waves. There's clear evidence that the aboriginals know about tsunamis and they know how to deal with them, he said. Samir Acharya, convener of the Society for Environment for Andaman Nicobar Ecology, called SANE, said the aboriginals have a collective memory of earthquakes and tsunamis, so they knew how to move to higher ground. Madhushree Mukherjee, author of The Land of the Naked People, supported the theory, saying the aboriginals have an island survival strategy that they have developed through the knowledge of the generations. Anthropologists and government officials compared notes on the tribe's behavior after the huge undersea earthquake that triggered the Indian Ocean tsunami that is now known to have killed more than 200,000 people in the region. K.C. Ghoshal, executive secretary of the Andaman Nicobar Tribal Welfare Department, spoke to some of the great Andamanese people taken to a rest house near the island's capital, Port Blair. He said the survivors spoke of feeling the earth shake and bringing their thatched huts crashing down, prompting an exodus to higher ground. We can now say we have contacted or carefully assessed the plight of the aboriginals, and we can say almost all of them are safe, he said, adding that officials hoped to return those taken to temporary shelters in the immediate aftermath. They have been much harassed by the media, and we plan to send them back to their areas without much delay, Mr. Ghoshal added. Mr. Chandi, who traveled to the affected areas as part of a team assessing the tsunami's environmental impact, said his research showed the Ongyes living at Dugong Creek and South Bay on Little Andaman Island were almost wholly safe. He added that the Jarawa tribe along the west coast of South and Middle Andaman Islands was also largely safe. Most of the Jarawas appeared to be deep in the jungles, hunting wild boar and staying away from the beaches where they would usually catch turtles, another favourite food. Further afield, the Sentinelese people appear not to have been affected, Mr. Ghoshal added. They continued to remain isolated and even shot arrows at the naval helicopter on patrol which had descended or was flying low on the North Sentinel Island to check, he said. There are some concerns for the Shompens, the last of the island's five groups that are considered native, though some say they are originated in Africa. The Shompens live inland and deep in the forest, and the government's tribal welfare department is not sure how many, if any, casualties they suffered. A helicopter that hovered over their habitat seems to have scared them, and they have all fled into very dense jungles. So it will be a while before a clear assessment will emerge, Mr. Ghoshal said. But on research on the more southern Nicobar part of the archipelago suggests that the tribes who are not indigenous to the islands fared far less well. Thousands of Nicobaris, who some say migrated from Southeast Asia 500 or 600 years ago, are dead or missing. Many of the islands suffered more in the huge waves, in some cases being washed off the horizon entirely. And even those who survived face more dangers along with their aboriginal fellow island dwellers, partly because of the renewed interest in them from outside Andaman held from outside. Cut, retake. And even those who survive face more dangers along with their aboriginal fellow island dwellers, partly because of the renewed interest in them from outside. Andaman health expert Tilak Behra, an Indian Navy doctor with close knowledge of the aboriginals, said they can cope with tsunamis, but they will find it difficult to cope with disease that the settlers have brought to the islands. I'm sure they have tightened themselves over the tsunami with their collective knowledge, but I'm apprehensive about the diseases that may afflict them because of the exposure to outside society and unfamiliar food they had to eat after displacement. It may be a very sad repetition of history for the tribe's people. In the 19th century, when the last massive earthquake struck the Indian Ocean, many thousands died in measles, pneumonia, and cholera epidemics when they came into contact with outsiders. This was as far as the articles go. Now comes the critique written by me. The truth remains that the tsunami hardly scarred the coast inhabited by the Jarabas, the great Andamanese, Ongis, and Sentinelese, who live in the Middle Andaman, Little Andaman, and the North Sentinelese Islands respectively, which are located in the Andaman district of Andaman Nicobar Islands, north of the 10 degrees channel. The tsunami smashed the Nicobars, inhabited by the Nicobarese and the Champans, south of the 10 degrees channel. Here in the Nicobar Islands, at least 3,513 people died in the tsunami. So if the reporters had verified how many Nicobaris and the Champans were affected or protected by their traditional wisdom from the tsunami, there would have been merit in the claim that the traditional wisdom of the tribes protected them from natural calamity. The truth emerged that 2,955 Nicobaris perished in the tsunami. About 31 Champans were missing even a month after the Asian tsunami, according to official statistics. The reports from the popular press begged for a geomorphological clarification. Great Andamanese, Jarabas, Ongays, and the Sentinelese live in islands of the Andaman district, north of the 10 degrees channel, which separate Andamans from Nicobars. Secondly, Andamans were not as affected by the tsunami as the Nicobars were. Nicobarese and Champans, both of Malay origin living in Nicobar district, unlike the Negrito origins of the Jarabas, Ongays, Sentinelese and the Great Andamanese, were severely affected by the tsunami. So, news reports that stone-age tribes of Andaman Nicobar Islands were spared the onslaught of the tsunami thanks to their traditional wisdom, but those who migrated only a few centuries ago were severely affected by the tsunami, borders on churlish and disrespect to the published word. It also exposed the low level of research, perhaps because in the immediate aftermath of the calamity, research was not very practical. It also exposed the low level of research, moreover, to say that those who migrated 500 to 600 years ago from one region succumbed to the tsunami, but others who migrated millennia ago from Africa survived the tsunami, almost hinges on racism. If indeed traditional wisdom of the indigenous peoples helped save lives, then it ought to be documented thoroughly, academically, in peer-reviewed journals and publications, should be subject to debate and critiques, and lessons learned from such disasters ought to become policy guidelines in disaster mitigation for the wider mainstream society too. Indeed, former director of Anthropological Survey of India, Professor V.R. Rao, was right in saying that the indigenous people's reading of early warning signals, either lack of birds chirping or withdrawal of the sea or cetacean stranding, might be more cost-effective early warning signals. But these are precisely non-cognitive and speculative conjecture that the scientific community refuses to accept. We will learn more about this in Chapter 19 on early warning. Seen geomorphologically, the islands inhabited by the Ongays, Jarabas, Great Andamanese, and Sentinelese, where the Negrito tribes live in Little Andaman, Barathang, Strait Island, and North and South Sentinel Islands respectively, did not feel the power of the tsunami waves as much as the Nicobar Islands. The Nicobarese and the Champans who inhabit the Nicobar Islands were nearer to the epicenter, and the local tsunamis generated by the earthquake swarm after the mega earthquake, hence the Nicobarese and the Champans suffered more fatalities and casualties. Reports of Nicobarese running to hilly terrain remain credible of only a couple of islands. Great Nicobar Island, Komorta and Trinket Islands in Nicobar district south of the 10 degrees channel in the southern group of Nicobar Islands have hilly terrain. Yet the Nicobaris suffered widespread death and destruction. "We instinctively ran to higher grounds like the hills," said Aslam of Nankauri in an exclusive discussion with me in Komorta on the 5th of March 2014 when I was there. Though Komorta is hilly, thousands were affected. About 800 people died in Komorta. In Great Nicobar Island, which is the largest island in Nicobars and also largely hilly, the Champans live in the hinterland of the island. Only the rare Champans who were out fishing were caught unawares. Swampins are largely hunter-gatherers dwelling in the interior forests, while the Nicobaris are coastal-dwelling fisher folk. Barnabas Manju of Puro Bay in Campbell Bay or Great Nicobar Island lost his wife and two sons in Great Nicobar, Campbell Bay. He and his daughter were saved only because they were visiting his parents' house in Kondur Island on the northern shores of Campbell Bay for Christmas. His wife and two sons living near the Arecanut plantations of Puro Bay in southern Campbell Bay died in the tsunami. We had never heard of nor had learned of a tsunami. We had only learned that when the earth shakes in a huge earthquake, we need to run to the sea shore to protect ourselves from falling objects like rocks, trees, coconuts or houses, he said. This was generally the refrain from all the Nicobari survivors I interviewed across five villages in Carnicobar, three villages in Kamortha, one villager from Kondur, and four villages in Campbell Bay or Great Nicobar Island. Another critical issue, Strait Island is hidden from the Bay of Bengal as it is on the east coast of the Andaman Islands in the Andaman Sea, whereas the south and west coasts of most of the Nicobar Islands were smashed by the tsunami. Consequently, settlements exposed to or proximal to the south and west coasts of the islands were more affected by the tsunami. Islands farther from the epicenter of the mega earthquake and source of tsunamis were lesser affected. Secondly, given the earthquake swarm that was triggered by the mega earthquake off the Nicobar Islands also triggered local tsunamis, adding to the force of the main tsunami tearing off from the epicenter. And with that, we come to tonight, end of tonight's session. In our next week's video, we will continue with traditional wisdom of indigenous people for disaster mitigation. Does it help? Where and how? Please do subscribe to our channel and share the videos in your circles and networks, because we need your support and encouragement to start a whole web series on disaster mitigation. Please don't forget to tune in to the live interaction around 7:30 p.m. Indian time on Saturday evening, 14th August 2021. I hope to catch you during the live interaction, and I'm really looking forward to this very interesting interaction, and I'm sure it will be. Until then, take care, ciao, keep smiling, stay safe, and stay home.